To see a lot of people that I've never seen before. Yeah, so welcome to you guys. You're the teams from, it's Texas and Mississippi, I think, right? Awesome. Great to see you guys. I'm glad to be back. I was gone last weekend, but I missed you. yeah, so if you're able to, invite you to stand with us as we're leading into worship here this evening. This first song that we're going to do, it's called King of My Heart. The chorus, it's really, really simple. It's just, sometimes having these choruses, having these songs where we sort of just repeat the same thing over and over and over again. In my mind, I find that, like, sometimes it can get a little bit tedious. It's like, why are we just saying these exact same words over and over and over again? But what I found is when I really, like, am intentional about, like, thinking about it and pressing into the words that we're singing, as we're singing, it's almost like God just kind of keeps on revealing new ways that this is true, that these words that we're singing are true. So let's just take a moment here. Let's just sing this chorus together. And let's just take a moment just to sort of center our hearts, center our minds, and focus on the ways that God is good, focus on the ways that God is faithful, and we'll just continue to worship. So let's sing together.
You are good. Never gonna let me down.
Oh,
Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Jesus paid.
Jesus paid it all. For me, not against me, I am.
And so his plan was he's going to come out on stage with his electric guitar
and he's gonna start the show that way, and then he would move into his acoustic guitar, and he would sort of do some music stuff and some stand-up stuff, and so we're all waiting for him to come, and we're the host church, and I'm sitting back by the soundboard, and that's never a good idea. Let me just warn you, don't ever sit near the soundboard, because I'm back there. And the man that we had running sound, I'm so thankful for Samra tonight, doing a great job on the board. The guy that we had running our board was not real mobile. And so so he couldn't really, like, he had to use an electric wheelchair to get around. And so we were in this big church sanctuary. So for anybody to get from the soundboard, it's way at the back, and you got to go all the way down. Ask any bride that was married at our church, and like, it's a long aisle. And so we're sitting there, and you know, everyone's pumped up for this concert, and then all of a sudden, Tim Hawkins runs out on stage. He's got his electric guitar, and he goes to start playing, and like, nothing happens. And it's like the worst thing ever. He comes and he just, and as only a comedian can do, right? He sort of made some jokes about it, and he's, you know, but as the silence continues, it's getting more and more awkward, and nothing's happening. And to my horror, our sound guy looks at me and says, "Mike, go down there and fix it." And like, there's like 2,000 people in the sanctuary, and they're all sort of, you know, nervously laughing. And he's like, "Mike, go down there." And like, "I have no time to do anything." And so I get up and I start walking down this aisle. And like, on the way down, what's going through my head is, I have no idea how to run sound stuff. I've always been a musician. I've always been on this side of everything. And so I'm walking down, and I don't even know where to begin. Like, and so 2,000 pairs of eyes are watching me walk all the way to the front. I have no idea what to do. And of course, you know, the comedian on stage is going to roast the guy who's coming just to kill time. So he's throwing all kinds of, back in the southern folks say, he's throwing shade on me. He's throwing all sorts of shade on me. And I'm just like, yeah, you know, big fan, you know, talk to you after the show. And I just sort of look at his rig. So I'm up there, kind of, it was kind of similar to Jake's up here, but a lot more. And I'm looking at him just like, I don't know what to do. So I'm like unplugging things, plugging them in, like just kind of testing to make sure it's plugged in all the way. And he's like, "That's my acoustic guitar." Like, you know, I was messing with the wrong stuff. I'm like, "Oh, sorry." I'm like, "I wanted to mess up like act two or something." So I start messing around. Like, I never do figure it out. Like how could I? I have no idea what to do. And so I mess around up there, embarrass myself for a little bit, and finally he makes some joke like, "Well, you know, we're just gonna move on to the next part of the show," and go, and I do like the walk of shame all the way back to my seat, because nobody else knows that I have no idea what I'm, like, they're all expecting, like, this is the most incompetent sound guy ever. Like, he doesn't know what he's doing. I'm like, "You are absolutely right. That is why I'm not the sound guy." I didn't have the knowledge I needed to fix the problem. And if you've ever been there in any number of circumstances in your life, it's not a great place to be, right? When you find yourself in that situation and you realize, I don't have what it takes to fix the problem in front of me. And there's more serious things, right, than messing up a comedy concert. Maybe it's fatherhood or motherhood, or maybe it's trying to be a good wife or husband, or maybe it's you're quite a ways into your college degree, or what is it for you? Maybe you're in a job, and at a certain point, you just get to that place where you're like, I don't know if I have what it takes to do what I'm doing. And maybe you've been hit with a little bit of panic at that moment. Like, what am I gonna do? As humans, we've collectively learned a lot in our history. Together, none of us knows everything, but all of us together know quite a bit, right? And that's what's great in our interconnected world. We have access, and you can pull up Google, and you can know just about anything that the human race knows right now. And what's fascinating, I read this a little while back, what's fascinating is that even now, our computer technology is getting to the place where like, computers are going beyond us, and they're starting to do things that we could never even dream of an age ago. And so I want to tell you about something that's fascinating. I'm just going to read this straight out of the book that I got it from. On December 7th, 2017, a critical milestone was reached.
not when a computer defeated a human at chess. That's old news. But when Google's AlphaZero program defeated the Stockfish 8 program. Stockfish 8 was the world's computer chess champion for 2016. It had access to centuries of accumulated human experience in chess, as well as decades of computer experience in chess. It was able to calculate, check this out, 70 million chess positions per second. So, 70 million chess positions every second. In contrast, AlphaZero, this is this new program, performed only 80,000. Only 80,000. Thought you were going to play chess. Only 80,000 per second, and its human creators had not taught it any chess strategies, not even standard openings. So you've got the grand champion computer chess player against like the Rocky of computer chess. Rather, AlphaZero used the latest machine learning principles to self-learn chess by playing against itself. Nevertheless, out of 100 games, the novice AlphaZero played against Stockfish. AlphaZero won 28 and tied 72. It didn't lose even once. Since AlphaZero had learned nothing from any human, many of its winning moves and strategies seemed unconventional to the human eye. They may well be considered creative, if not downright genius. Can you guess how long it took AlphaZero to learn chess from scratch, prepare for the match against Stockfish, and develop its genius instincts? 4 hours. That's not a typo. For centuries, chess was considered one of the crowning glories of human intelligence. AlphaZero went from utter ignorance to creative mastery in 4 hours without the help of any human guide. And so we're living in an age that is not just that we're in an information age where we as humans collectively have learned a lot and have accumulated a lot of knowledge. We also are developing technology that is going well beyond where we even are. However, in our information age, it's easy to confuse knowledge with wisdom. And they're not the same thing. We are still asking the same foundational questions about purpose, about love, about morality. And so tonight I want to talk about where can we find wisdom that makes sense of our deepest questions? Because what we see in our history is as we accumulate more and more knowledge, it's not necessarily answering our deepest questions. Because we're still seeking these things out. We're still asking these questions, saying we've got entire encyclopedias worth of knowledge on our phones through Google, and yet people are still asking, what is love? What is morality? What is my purpose? Like, why am I here? And so I want to take you to a letter that Paul wrote. Apostle Paul wrote about some of these things to a church in Corinth. And I had the opportunity to visit ancient Corinth. You can go there today. This is my brother and I pretending to be statues because we visited ancient Corinth a long time ago when I was an immature young man. and so we're pretending to be statues. I don't think we fooled anyone. And so that's ancient Corinth in the background, a real fascinating ancient city, and actually a city with a lot of philosophies and religions and one of those cities where up this hill is actually, you've actually got these temples that were really dedicated to the god of love, really the god of lust in a lot of ways, and there were some bad things that happened. We've got young ears in the room, won't go into it, but there were some bad things that happened in these temples, and what you found in ancient Corinth was a lot of people with a lot of religious and philosophical options. They had a lot of knowledge around them. They had a lot of spirituality around them. And I would argue, in some ways, much like we have today, much like Victoria. There's any number of philosophies and religions and spiritualities that are attempting to answer our deepest questions. In our information age, where we have more knowledge than ever before, there are people who are still searching. I would argue all of us, seeking out answers to these questions. And so I want to take you to the book of 1 Corinthians as Paul addresses people, a church, in this culture of Corinth. He said, for the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to those who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? And he goes on and says, for since in the wisdom of God, so now he's contrasting. There's the wisdom of God, the wisdom of the world. He says, for the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom. See, as people tried to discover and figure out who God is, they could never do it. They could never get all the way to God, no matter how much wisdom they accumulated. It pleased God through the folly, really just meaning foolishness. You look, that's folly. That's foolishness. That doesn't make sense. That goes against conventional wisdom. It says the folly of what we preach to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to the Jews and folly to the Gentiles. Because what we preach doesn't make sense to these two major groups, right? That's kind of how they saw everybody. You were either part of the Jews or part of the Greeks or the Gentiles. He says, what we're preaching is tripping up everybody. It's the stumbling block to everybody because it goes against expectation. It goes against what they assume should be true. See, the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, really, which means those who reject it because they don't believe they need it. So that's foolishness. I don't need that. I don't need that in my life. That doesn't make sense. But to those who see their need and accept the work of Jesus on the cross, it's powerful. It's the power of God in the lives of those people. See, the scribes and the debaters of our day, those were sort of the intelligentsia, right? The academics, those who were the educated ones, those who were the philosophers, the ones who seemed to have all the fresh ideas and would debate all these ideas. And I would say that the scribes of our day and the debaters of our day often attempt to leave the cross out of their wisdom, right? When they come to the same gospel that Paul preached, it's ridiculed today too. And it's often treated with a certain amount of doubt or skepticism. Or if you're Richard Dawkins, it's treated with, go ahead to the next one, Jack. If you're Richard Dawkins, he says, his definition of faith is to believe in spite of, or perhaps even because of, the lack of evidence. So he says, when there's no evidence for something, then that's when you believe that thing. I've got two comments towards that. I've got more, but here's two. One is I would always ask, how do you define evidence? Right? Is there a gold standard for what is enough evidence? It's different for everybody. Right? Somebody's convinced by a certain amount of evidence. Maybe somebody else needs much more. I mean, we're all different, right? And so for someone to say that there's no evidence, really what he's saying is there's no evidence that convinces me. Because there's plenty of evidence. And if you're interested in some of that, there's some books on the back, More Than a Carpenter by Josh McDowell. Those are for you to take. So if you're interested in diving into some of the philosophy stuff of this and really digging in, take one of those. It's for you to take and to keep and to read. And so it's not that there's no evidence, it's that there's evidence that he sees is insufficient for his own belief. And so you got to define evidence. But the other thing, this is what one of my favorites, this is what Pascal says. Jack, you can go to that next one. Pascal says, there is enough light for those who only desire to see, and enough obscurity for those of a contrary disposition. He says, if your heart is really seeking, then there's enough evidence for you. But if your heart is not interested, if you've already made up your mind, then you're going to see exactly what you expect to see, right? You're going to discount whatever evidence there is because you've already made up your mind. But the second issue I take with what Dawkins is saying is that he's a scientist. The most brilliant minds in science all throughout history have been Christians, motivated by their faith. Jack, go to that next slide. So here's just a quick snapshot of the who's who of science. From top left, to write. Francis Collins, he was the guy in charge of the Human Genome Project, so that maps the human genome. Strong Christian, wrote a great book talking about science and his faith. Blaise Pascal, who we just quoted, brilliant mathematician, scientist. Francis Bacon, famous for really developing the scientific method. Galileo, who stirred the hornet's nest a little bit because of his science. Johannes Kepler, Isaac Newton, Rene Descartes, Michael Faraday. I mean, as you go through the who's who of science, you're like, Christian, Christian, Christian. And oftentimes, it wasn't just accidental, but they were motivated by their faith to study the natural world because they believed in a rational God that created the universe. And so they believed as they studied the physical universe, it would teach them things about God. Because it was a reflection. Just like if you study the paintings that James does, it should tell you some things about the painter. As you study creation, it teaches you about the creator. And so I put a book on the back table. Sometimes have some pastoral recommendations. There's a great book by Rodney Stark back there. Take a picture of it if you're interested. He argues that science in the West actually came out of a Christian worldview. Not just that there was a lot of Christians who were scientists, but that science as we know it developed because of a Christian worldview and could not have developed if those pieces were not in place. And so it's a fascinating read. It's a thick book, so you may order it and just read that chapter, but it's a great book. Jack, you can go to the next one. Paul goes on to say, and so you start seeing the foolishness of the world and God's wisdom, and there's these two versions of wisdom. And Paul goes on and says, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks. So he's saying, look, it can be a stumbling block to everybody, or it could be something else. You don't have to stumble over this message. He says, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God, for the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. Is there another verse there, Jack? I can't remember. Does it go on? Or is it just the one slide? It might just be the one slide. Goes on and says, we'll come back to that. Go back to that first one. The message of Jesus turns our wisdom upside down. The fact that Jesus was not a political activist confused the Jews. That's what they were expecting. And the fact that he preached and displayed grace and humility confused the Greeks. See, the Greeks didn't put a whole lot of stock in their gods. The Greek gods were just essentially really powerful humans with all of the human flaws that come with it, right? They were mostly bickering among each other, and so you would pray, and maybe Zeus would answer you, maybe somebody would help you, but for the most part, Greeks were all about their own internal wisdom. Like, let's figure out this problem ourselves, because the gods aren't really going to help us that much. And so for the gospel to say, no, Jesus came to serve. He didn't come as a political activist to flip upside down the Roman Empire. And the Greeks were confused by, why are we having to look outward and not inward for our wisdom? Why do we call out to a God who is out there? That doesn't make sense to our way of thinking. Because wasn't Jesus supposed to use power to rule the way earthly kings did? Why did his wisdom point to something beyond ourselves for saving, rather than something within ourselves to save us? Jesus didn't fit people's expectations. And Jack, you can go to that quote. And I think this is often what we run into, is we try to judge God by our standards rather than examining ourselves by his standards. And have you seen that? Where some of your ideas about who God is, you ask yourself, where did those come from? Did those come because I read about who God is in the Bible, and I've come to know who God is through experience through the Bible? Or do I view God through the lens of other experiences that I've had? And I know for many, oftentimes hearing God referred to as a father is difficult because of their own experience with a bad father in their life. And all of a sudden, they start seeing God as some oppressive, restrictive, dictator in the sky who just wants to put rules in their life and tell them what to do. And oftentimes our view of who God is more driven by the things that we have experienced and the lens that we're viewing through, rather than the truth of what Scripture teaches us about God. And so the issue of truth is not dependent on what we like or what we want, or even what we fully understand. I don't really understand aerodynamics. But when I get on an airplane and it does its thing, I'm like, well, there's something true about aerodynamics because this plane is flying and I'm experiencing this plane fly. Don't understand what's happening and what's going on, but that doesn't change the truth, right? I may not even like it. I may be like, well, I don't like that. I like cars. I think planes have taken away from the automobile industry or whatever I might say. And be like, well, it doesn't matter if I like it or not. What I like doesn't determine what is true. What I even understand doesn't determine what is true. And so I want to figure out what is true. And then I want to base my beliefs off of the solid foundation of what is true. And so is the message of the cross of Jesus true? That's the question that we need to ask, is not do I like it, not do I want it to be true, but is the message of the cross that Paul is talking about, this godly wisdom that seems to not make sense from our own perspective of worldly wisdom, is it true or is it false? Because everything else needs to reorient around that fact. Because if it is true, that changes everything. And all my other beliefs need to align and rearrange around that fact, because that's one of those facts that changes everything. Oftentimes in science, you'll have this sort of paradigm shift where they'll discover something new, and there's this new law that they discover and say, like, this changes that, like Galileo, right? It's like, okay, guys, we've got to rethink all these other things that we believe, because this truth that we've discovered is so significant that it bleeds its way into all these other things that we believe. That's Jesus and the cross. If this is true, if this message that Paul is preaching is true, then it changes everything around it. So Jack, you can go to those last verses. And Paul closes this little section by saying this. He makes it personal for the people he's writing to. So now it's not just, you know, these ideas and these theoreticals and these people. It's them. He's like, for consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise. And we've talked about this before. A lot of people say that Christianity only spread among the unwise or the uneducated. And that's not true, right? Movements don't spread that way. It has to be picked up by people of influence, by influencers in the culture, or else any movement, religious or non-religious, is never going to spread throughout society. And so he says, not many of you were wise. But he doesn't say, like, none of you. He says, but not many of you. So he's speaking to this group saying, look, you don't have to be a certain way to get this. Like, you don't have to be the philosopher. You don't have to have all this power. You don't have to have all this money. You don't have to be this position in society. He says, look at yourselves. He says, not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. All these paradoxes. He says, God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. You can go to that next one, Jack. And he closes the section, says, and because of him, you are in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God. Says this wisdom was given to us. This is not something we figured out. This was given to us. It says wisdom from God, righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Those are some big words that mean right standing before God. Sanctification is growing into the character that matches the character of God, and redemption meaning to be saved. You were redeemed. You were in a heap of trouble with no way out, and God paid what was needed to be paid for you to get out of that. It says, so that, as it is written, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. He's saying all these people who boast in their own wisdom, who think they have it all figured out, they don't have it all figured out, because nobody does. He says, let the one who boasts boast in the Lord, the God who has saved them. It puts us all on level ground together. It's not saying, well, these guys figured it out because they're smarter than everybody else. It's saying, no, everybody's on the same level ground. And anyone who boasts can't boast in themselves. They boast in the Lord. Any person who would humble himself, receive by faith the truth of the cross, will be forgiven and brought into relationship with God through Jesus. It is a realization that on our own, we don't have what it takes. You can go to that picture, Jack. The person who climbs to the top of Mount Everest, who are they going to boast in? They're going to be like, guess who's got two thumbs and climbed to the top of Mount Everest? This guy, right? The person who gets trapped halfway up Everest and needs a helicopter to come in and rescue him before he dies and pulls him off of that mountain and saves him from getting losing his fingers and his toes through frostbite and dying on the side of the mountain, who's he going to boast in? Is he going to be like, "Who? Look who almost lost his thumbs and climbed halfway up Mount Everest?" He's going to say, "Let me boast in the one who rescued me. What I didn't have the ability to do, somebody else came in and saved me, and I'm going to toot their horn. I'm going to tell you about them, because if it were not for them, I would have died. The truth of the cross is that someone came from the outside to save us who could not save ourselves from the inside." And that goes against the wisdom of the world. I want to tell you about one last person, and then we'll close. It's a lady named Nancy Piercy. She's a brilliant thinker. Her book that I highly recommend is also on the recommended table back there. And she grew up in sort of a Lutheran home, kind of a religious home. But when she was a teenager, she left all of it. She said, "I'm going to figure this out for myself," and became very skeptical, became an agnostic, and just said, I don't think that this stuff matches up. I don't think that this stuff is true," and rejected the faith that her parents had brought her up in. And then she ends up over with Francis Schaeffer's ministry, and we won't go all into that. Francis Schaeffer's one of my heroes. I think he's awesome. We'll talk about him at some other time. But she ends up over in Switzerland at this really Swiss chalet, like a real Swiss chalet, not the restaurant. And Francis Schaeffer is running a ministry out of this chalet in the Alps, where seekers and skeptics could come, and if they did the dishes and did the chores, then they would be able to board at their house, and they would have these conversations about stuff like this. And so you would have these hippies and these seekers and these folks come from all over the world. They would travel to Francis Schaeffer's little chalet and say, I just want to get around somebody and talk about what Christianity is all about. And they would talk and they would debate, and Schaeffer would give lectures. And she goes and checks that out. And it starts to really convict her, and she only stays a month and then leaves. And she's like, "I don't know, there's something crazy going on here." But as she leaves, she starts to think more about it. She realizes, you know, what those guys are talking about, it goes against everything that I believe. And yet, it answers all these fundamental questions that I have. In fact, their worldview seems to be built on a foundation that is much more sturdy than my worldview. What is it at their foundation that I don't have at my foundation? And she realizes that the folly of her own wisdom was actually like a house without good foundation. You put that picture up, Jack. She was realizing that her house of her beliefs was built on a foundation that couldn't hold it up. She believed in the dignity of the human being and fundamental human rights, but she couldn't answer where those came from. What are they? You can't look at a human right under a microscope. You can't study it, scientifically. What is this thing? Where does it come from? And why should we acknowledge these things in each other? And where does morality come from? Is it not just things that we make up? Or are they not rules that we just decide, and we decide to play by whatever rules we are in our society? What if society changes the rules, right? What if I'm in Nazi Germany and all of a sudden society is saying it's okay to do things that I don't think it's okay to do? Like, who's the referee that says one is right and one is wrong? Like, where do you go to figure that out? And she starts realizing, I believe in objective morality, but I can't base it on anything. She's like, I believe that human beings have purpose and that we're not just supposed to kind of float through life figuring things out on our own, but where does purpose come from? Like, who gives me my function? Who gives me my purpose? If I'm just an accident of a bunch of colliding atoms that have sort of worked their way together over millions of years, and then all of a sudden, like, here I am, and one day I'm going to be gone, and not have really lasted beyond just the time I put in on Earth, like, then what's my purpose? What do I live for? If life is bad right now, why do I keep living if there's nothing to look forward to beyond this? And she realized that the folly that the Christians were preaching actually made sense of all of her deepest questions in a way that her own worldview did. And so she gives her her life to God. And the power of God, the folly of the message of the cross, becomes real for her as she realizes, if this is true, then that changes everything about who I am and where my destiny is and what my life is all about. And it flipped everything around for her. And now she's one of the great Christian apologists of our day. And so I'm going to invite Jake back up, and he's going to lead us in a final song. Really a time to reflect, a time for us to say, okay, well, that's great for all those people that were on the screen, but what about me? Like, what does this mean for me? Because I don't believe that the Christian faith is meant to just stay in our head, right? There's a lot we could talk about. It's interesting stuff. But if that's all it is, then, like, that's just knowledge, right? But what does wisdom do? Wisdom is applied knowledge. Wisdom is saying, these things are true. Now this is how those things are meant to work out in your life. And so for you tonight, I would ask you, have you been trying to live life on your own wisdom? Have you been going through life saying, every time I face a problem, every time I face an issue, when I'm looking at what I'm going to do with my life, I'm going to school, I'm trying to pick a major, I'm trying to think, when I graduate, what's life going to look like? When I'm looking towards marriage, I'm like, am I going to get married? Who am I going to get married to? Like, do I want to start a family? Like, maybe you're in another side of life where you're saying, man, I'm retired, and I'm wondering if my best days are behind me, and I'm wondering, does God have something new for me? Like, what do I do? Because the wisdom of the world is always pointing to the younger generation and saying, they're our future, they're our today. And maybe tonight you would say, and what if I'm not in that generation? Like, what is there for me? Do I just kind of retire and play golf and try not to get in anybody's way? Or does God have purpose for me? Does God have things he can do unique in my life that goes against the wisdom of the world? Things that goes against my own wisdom? Might God look at me and say, I'm not finished with you yet. I've got more for your life. And it may not even make sense to you. It may not make sense to anyone else around you. But that's okay. Because the wisdom of God makes the wisdom of the world foolishness. How have you been trying to live your life? Proverbs says this. Jack, you can put this up. It says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. And so I would encourage you tonight, I don't know where you are in your life. I don't know how you've been going through life. Maybe it's been on your own wisdom. Maybe you put a lot of confidence in yourself. And you're like, man, I've got the brains and the talents that I can do this thing okay on my own. Maybe you've had experiences in your life that have shown you that that's not true. And you're like, I thought I could do that, and I realize I can't. Maybe you're facing some big decisions. Maybe you're looking out over your future and you're like, I'm a little nervous to walk into my future because I'm not sure what to do. Maybe you're like I was, up at the front of the church, 2,000 people looking at you, and you're like, I have no idea what to do. Reached the end of my abilities. But maybe in your life it's a much more serious situation. Maybe the things that it could cost you or other people to make the wrong decision are a bigger deal than just some embarrassment. Maybe you're a parent, maybe you're a grandparent, and you're like, man, I don't want to mess my kids up. I need wisdom that is beyond the best self-help books out there. Like, I need wisdom beyond what I've already got, because they're worth it. Because I need God to show me what to do in life. If God has a purpose for me, I need him to show me what it is. Paul would say it begins at the cross. The cross, which is foolishness to those who are perishing. For those who don't think they need it, it doesn't make any sense at all. But to those who have been saved, to those who have gone halfway up the mountain and needed somebody to rescue them, it's not foolishness, it's power. Say, man, if not for the power of God, I don't know where I'd be. And so do you need God's wisdom in your life? Go to the cross. On that foundation, a house can stand. Pray to the one who is infinitely wise to give you wisdom that you need to honor him with your life. And so in these moments, as Jake leads us in one final song, let's take some time to pray. You pray directly to the God of wisdom. Say, God, what needs to change in my life? Would you give me the wisdom I need that I might honor you with every day that you give me, leading into the future? So let's do that together. That's Jake. why James is able to be with us, because he puts visual to some great truth. And if you're a visual person like I am, love being able to get a picture of some deep truth. And so, go ahead and use James' mic.
This is basically just a portrait of the girl who you're talking about at the end. I found a picture of her playing the violin on the internet, and so I kind of composed this prose. It wasn't exactly like this, but I just wanted to show somebody who was saved, somebody who used their heart and their mind, and came to a knowledge of faith. And is doing amazing things for the kingdom of God. So that's a portrait of her. And I think that we're a song. Anyone who comes and seeks the Lord and humbles themselves, and God infuses his life into them because of the blood of Messiah, that's an amazing song. And so that's kind of the metaphor of the violin and that painting. That's the journey of faith, and it's a beautiful.
As you look around at paintings around the room, these are all visual representations of messages that have been preached here and done by James. And so if you're ever interested in one of those, come talk to me, talk to James. If it's something that maybe God speaks to you really directly in one of these services and you want a visual reminder of when God did that, that's kind of what these are for. And they just look good. But it's meant to be reminded of the things of God. A couple of announcements for you. One just being these envelopes are on the different seats, and there's some in the back. If you're a first-time visitor with us, I know a bunch of you guys are first-time visitors temporarily, so this is not necessarily for you, although I do want to meet you. But if you're a local who's here for the first time, if you wouldn't mind filling one of those out with some whatever you're comfortable putting on there, your information. There's a box in the back. Just go ahead and fill that out, drop that in there if that's something you're feeling led to do. Just how it gives us a record of your visit and allows me to reach out to you and send you an email and then just say thanks for being here. Actually, no. If you're a first-time person, bring that to me. I forgot. I got a gift for you. And so don't put it in the box. Bring it to me. I would love to exchange that card for just a small gift to say thanks for being here tonight. There's other things that you may want to fill in there if you have questions, or all of that can go in the box. If you're a regular and you're feeling God leads you to give towards the ministries of what we do at Canvas, there's instructions on how to do that on the back. You can do that in one of these and drop it in that box at the back as well. Hey, let me tell you about a couple serving opportunities that are coming up. You know that at Canvas we value Jesus, relationships, families, and our community. And there's some great opportunities coming up that really combine all of those in some neat ways. And we don't want to be a church that just sort of drops into town and says, here's all the things that we're doing, come to all of our things. We do some of that where we feel it will benefit the community and reach folks. But we also want to say, what is Oak Bay and what is community doing already that we can come alongside of them and say, hey, we want to be in amongst the people of our community. These are the people that God has called us to reach and to share the love of Jesus with by serving. And so there's some great opportunities coming up for that. There are sign-up sheets for two of those at the back. Just if you would like to jump in on one or both of these, or however you're feeling led. One is the Oak Bay Tea Party is coming up the first weekend of June. Some of you guys from out of town are thinking, like, tea party? You guys are sort of like, you know, we all sit around and sip tea. There is tea, but it's the biggest event that Oak Bay does all year. It's huge. Thousands of people come. There's midway rides all at Willows Park, and there's all sorts of things. There's live music, there's food, there's all sorts of stuff. that Saturday is a parade, June 1st. That Saturday, there's a big parade that goes all the way through Oak Bay. We volunteered last year, and they were so thankful for that, that they came to us this year and said, would your church send some more volunteers this year to help? And like I said last week, if you can put on an orange safety vest and stand at a barricade and make sure that cars aren't driving around it, you've got the skill set that you need to be able to do what we're doing. And so it's real simple. We'll meet at Sarah and I's place. We live just a few blocks from Willows Beach. Meet at our place at 9 o'clock. Eat some Tim Hortons donuts, because that's what you do in the morning when you're serving. And then we'll burn the calories by walking over to where the parade is. If you're unable to walk longer distances, there'll be a driving option as well. And we'll go over to Windsor Park. And from there, they'll give us our t-shirts, our safety vests. They'll tell us which intersection we're going to be at. We'll all load onto a bus. They'll drive and drop us off. I mean, super easy to drop you off at your intersection. You'll put the barricade together. You'll stand there, make conversation with people, make sure nobody's like driving into the parade. And then after the parade's over, the bus will come back, pick you up. You'll give them the safety vest, and they'll drop you off right at Willows Park. And so meet at our place at 9. We'll get to our places. The parade is at 10:30. Everything should be done by about 12 o'clock, just some time for lunch. And last year they gave us a food voucher for an awesome lunch, and then invited us to the amazing Oak Bay Volunteer Appreciation Dinner later that year. So they treat you really well, but that's not why we're doing it, right? The reason we're doing it is to say we want to serve like Jesus served. And if we want to be among the people that we believe God has called us to show that love to, then this is a chance to, if you want to love your neighbor, this is a chance to get around a lot of your neighbors and show them the love of Christ. That next Saturday, so if you're a glutton for punishment and you're just like, I want to serve that Saturday, I want to serve the next one, or if you're like, well, that Saturday doesn't work for me, but maybe the next one, here's a cool opportunity that came up this week. So I told you a few weeks ago that we were going to do a arts camp, and it kind of fell through because the group kind of like you guys that was going to come and help us was not able to do that, and it's pretty late in the game to try and change gears and figure out a plan B. And so we just prayed and said, God, if you don't want us to do this, show us what you do want us to do. And another event that Oak Bay does is Garagelenium, which is basically a giant community garage sale where dozens of homes all across the community have garage sale on the same day. And we had a garage sale during this last year, and me and the boys went treasure hunting. It's a great event. And me and Sarah were talking, and Sarah had this light bulb moment and was like, what if we provided some things for this? Like, what if we provided the bouncy houses that we got? And what if we got Josh's food truck to come over and do lunch? And next thing I know, I'm talking to the lady who organizes it, and I'm over at Municipal Hall brainstorming with the Municipal Hall people, and they say, well, we'll let you have the field behind Municipal Hall just down the street for free. You guys can set up your bouncy houses there. We'll advertise it in the Oak Bay News for free. You just send the volunteers. We're going to give up freezies and water. And then Josh, who they've been, if you didn't know, Josh and Jake and these guys, that food truck's been at the Highland Games all weekend, so they've been serving thousands of people. Non-for-profit food truck. They're going to let Josh come and park it right in the Municipal Hall parking lot. They're going to block off the parking lot. We're going to put tents and chairs up, and Canvas is going to subsidize a cheap lunch for kids, like a hot dog chips lunch. And then these guys, Josh, these guys are going to just serve their food truck menu, which if you haven't had it yet, it's awesome. They're parked Monday to Friday right outside of Chinatown, and it's great sort of fusion Indian cuisine. It's amazing stuff, and so we're going to get an opportunity to be a part of this great event that Oak Bay is doing, to add to it, to give a gift to our community, to the families of our community. And so if you want to be part of that, the hours are going to be similar to this other event. We'll get there in the morning, we'll set the bouncy houses up, we'll wear our fancy church shirts, and really, if you can stand at a bouncy house and count and make sure that there's not too many kids in the bouncy house and help them get in and out, you can set up tables and chairs, then you've got the skill set you need to help with that event. And so there's sign-up sheets for both of those things at the back. You guys are excited about God opening doors, right? We don't want to do things just to do them. I'm going to say, God, where do you lead? And how can we show your love to our community that might look at the cross right now as folly and foolishness? But we pray that as they see the power of God manifested in our life, they would say, you know what? There's something about these church people. There's something about these Christians. They're not better than me. They're not smarter than me. It's not that. But there's something in their life. There's a power in their life that goes beyond conventional wisdom. And I want to know what that power is, because I need that in my life. And we hope that putting ourselves in our community, blessing our community, loving our neighbors, we would be in that position to say, let me tell you about the one who saved me off the mountain. Let me tell you about the one who's powerful in my life, because it's not me. It's someone else. And so that's why we do what we do. One last thing. Our tennis camp is coming up at the end of July. If you've got kids that are grade 2 to grade 8, I encourage you to sign them up. If they've never touched a tennis racket in their life, that's fine. Had a bunch of those kids last year, and they were pros by the end. Ask the Burnsides. They're pros now, and I don't know how often you guys had ever even played. The folks who are coming to lead this camp are just top-notch from Texas. So just great, great folks. So let's stand together. I've talked enough. Let me pray for us. And then I encourage you. There's a lot of faces in the room that you may not know. A lot of these guys are heading back to the States in just a few days. But like I've said before, I believe that God has intersected our lives here for a purpose. And so whatever that is, whether we see each other until heaven again or not, God brought us together tonight. And there's significance to that. And so let me pray for us, and then we'll be done. God, we thank you. We thank you that our lives are not up to our own wisdom. Because, God, I know I would be in a lot of trouble if it was just up to what I know and what I can do and figure out on my own. And yet, God, the power of the cross is that what we couldn't do, you did. We just sang about it. We sang about amazing grace. The grace that looked at us and didn't leave us in our predicament. Didn't just have sympathy, but had empathy. That reached down to us, that came to us. God, you humbled yourself. Came to us. Suffered and died. And then rose again to prove that you are the power that can do in our lives what we cannot do for ourselves. And so we thank you for that. Thank you for each person in this room. Whatever they're facing in the days and months, years ahead, God, would you give them the wisdom that comes first from the cross? Would they have the fear of God, as you've said in Proverbs, so that they might have the beginning of wisdom, that we might face the coming days with confidence, because we trust the one who leads us. God, thank you. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for the opportunity to worship you.